this land of heavy metal.
So, this is heavy metal, dark, powerful, morbid. But in fact, this is not heavy metal. This is all Finnish traditional folk song. And what we have done here is just we played it exactly as the folk bands played, that we have just played with the heavy metal sound. So, here you can hear it. We kind of mix the metal and the accordion so you can hear that it's exactly the same song. So it seems that heavy metal has always been in Finland, but actually when I started in the 70s, heavy metal was totally out of fashion and it was a laughing stock. But now, 25 years later, Finland suddenly is the only country in the world that the heavy metal is mainstream. And that is very strange, and I really want to find out why.
No, eräs kotimainen rocklehti on käynyt kolumnistinsa suulla melko rankasti heavy rockin kimppuun. Hän toteaa muun muassa, että hevillä on selvät juuret suomalaisessa kulttuurissa Härmän häjyjen, Isontalon Antin ja muiden urpojen hahmossa. Onko hevi osa kansallista luonteen jäyhyyttämme ja pellavapäistä uhoamme, osa perämetsien, mistä on miehet tehty, mentaliteettiä? Onko näin, kuten on väitetty?
Joo, no hevihän tietysti on liittynyt tämmöinen jonkunlainen uhoaminen tämän musiikin luonteen vuoksi. Kuitenkin se mun käsittääkseni on enemmänkin hevin idea, että se purkaa tämmöisiä suomalaiskansallisia sisäisiä aggressioita paljon tehokkaammin kuin se, että juodaan pullo viinaa ja räyhätään. Kyllä tietysti onhan se uhominen suomalaista perusluonnetta, että siinä mielessä voi sanoa, että hevi liittyy siihen.
The so-called heavy rock started in the early 70s in Britain and America. And it was Alice Cooper's killer album that got Kimmo playing guitar. This interview was made in 1974, during his first visit to Finland.
And you know, we've never been here before. We've never been to Finland before. We've never played here. It's just a place we missed, I don't know how. But let you all know that we're still alive and kicking. We incorporated rock, hard rock, very hard rock with the theater. I think it's to the point now where rock groups just can't go up on stage with their Levi's on and say, come on, let's jam. You know, that's dead. That died in the 60s. This is a whole new thing where you have to come in and put a little icing on the cake.
When we had those great bands of the early 70s, you know, Free, Bad Company, Cream, Led Zeppelin, Jethro Tull, Black Sabbath, Deep Purple, Jesus, I mean, you know. Other people seem to have taken the ideas and, you know, and adapted them very well. And so now you've got bands like sort of Faith No More, and you've got bands like King's X and Soundgarden and Anthrax and people that are coming over with a real, you know, real attitude band.
Hello, Finland. We'll see you with Iron Maiden.
Heavy, 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 heavy.
By the late 70s, heavy rock had reached Finland, and Kimmo had bands Sarcophagus and Kimmo Kuusniemi Band. They released one single, three albums, and made a whole album-length music video, all well ahead of time, since metal or music videos didn't yet have an audience. Sarcophagus toured Finland and only dreamt of international success. Other early metal bands soon followed. Zero Nine, Riff Raff, Ossie, Tarot and Iron Cross are some of the early 80s names whose music crossed from rock into the metal genre. From those bands, at least Zero Nine and Tarot found a long-lasting recipe and have continued making music till today. Kimmo became a regular visitor in TV and radio, defending heavy rock to suspicious reporters. After a few years of back-breaking metal work, this pioneering band packed its bags and died a lonely death. It was all too much too soon. Finland wasn't ready for heavy. Yet. Inspired by his first music video experience, Kimmo became a film director and has been on that path ever since, living and working the last 16 years in UK, making films and music, with his partner, Tanja Katinka.
No miltä suomalaisen hevin nykytila näyttää noin ammattilaisen näkökulmasta tänään? Onko yleisöä ja riittääkö duunia?
No, kyllä sitä heviyleisö aina on ollut jo. Ja totani, heavy on kuitenkin ehkä semmoista musiikkia, mikä on aika pitkälti semmoisen tietyn harrastajoukon musiikkia. Tuskin sitä koskaan tulee mitään äärettömän suosittua musiikkia täällä. Ja kyllä sitä yleisö riittää, jos se hirveästi haluaa niin kuin, tai vaadi.
How wrong was he? In Kimmo's absence, Finland has become heavy metal crazy. And when the monster rock band Lordi won the Eurovision Song Contest, the popularity of Finnish metal became apparent to the rest of the world. A country known for its clean nature and mobile phones is now exporting metal music, and even President of Finland, Tarja Halonen, approves. It's time to travel back to old home country Finland to learn more. I give Kimmo and Tanja a lift to Stansted Airport.
This is the face that you hear talking.
Yes, I should be doing the voiceover for the next program, which is quite interesting. And quite important.
Quit with the helium.
Oh, hang on, no. Yeah, Stansted.
Kimmo's old hometown, capital of Finland, Helsinki. Famous for its architecture and culture. But having been away for a long time, Kimmo sees Finland with new eyes. It has a dark underbelly. Nowadays, the presence of heavy metal is everywhere. There are heavy metal bars and restaurants, clubs, and metal music venues. Even heavy metal karaoke. This is the land where long-haired Vikings roam the streets, all dressed in black. Heavy metal has even entered the Finnish Evangelic Lutheran Church, the Protestant main church of Finland. Heavy metal masses filled the benches. We meet the metal priest in an architect's dream, a church built inside a rock.
Originally, of course, like in the church and metal didn't mix in a way. So what changed and how do you pull it off?
It was kind of a surprise because you know that here in Finland, it's only 30 years ago when one guy brought a guitar here. And he, many people say that, no, you can't do it. It's like Satan's instrument or something like that.
So what happens in between to make heavy metal acceptable even by the church?
One main thing was Lordi.
Yes.
Because they won this Eurovision contest about 1 month before we got this mass.
All right. So
they were so surprised that it was just mass, but metal one. I mean, the music was so wonderful for them.
Yeah.
It was first time here in the same church, and it was full booked. People were so full of joy and full of word of God, or just they were so pleased. Many people wrote to our website that finally they have found something higher. They didn't know what, but it was something higher. Yeah.
Metal Mass is welcomed by those who feel alienated by the traditional church crowd. Band t-shirts are allowed here. Maybe this is just one sign of the relative tolerance of the Finnish culture.
We decided this Temppeli Aukio church. This is quite new church, but inside the rock.
It's kind of close to the nature.
So, you know. Then I just found that this is hard rock, hallelujah. Really, here.
For Kimmo, this is surprising. These guys are genuine and stand behind their metal message. They'll go touring next, and the Metal Mass album has made it to the music charts. But still, it seems like a long leap from church to Lordi.
And he was explaining there that when he came to this Temppeli Aukio in Kirkko, I felt that this is really hard rock, hallelujah. And
well, he said that.
He said that.
Oh, okay. Here in Finland, I think it was the Orthodox priest who was totally against us, who thought that we were satanic or something. Yeah. And in Greece, and there are still, you know, a lot of countries with big Orthodox, you know, communities that it doesn't matter what we say, they will absolutely, they believe that we are satanic. It's kind of funny that, you know, we have been accused of being Satanists, because there's no way in hell that, you know, any real satanic band would write a lyric called Hard Rock Hallelujah or Devil is a Loser.
Heavy rockin sisältöä sekä visuaalisesti että tekstien puolella leimaa tuollainen mystisyys, okkultismi, musta magia, saatanan palvonta ja muut melko vieraannuttavat asiat. Onko heavy rock nyt sitten eskapismia, ja jos on, niin miksi se on näin synkkä?
No eiköhän kaikkeen rockiin ja poppiin ja viihteeseen yleensäkin liity semmoinen tietty todellisuuspako, ja se kai sen tarkoituskin on, että se on arjen lomassa jotain viihdykettä. Ja noista sanojen aiheesta ne nyt sopii heviin, tuommoinen vähän tuonpuoleinen meininki. Ja sekään ei välttämättä ole aina saatananpalvonta ja mustaa magia, vaan sekin on aika monikäsitteinen juttu, ja sieltä löytyy kaikenlaista mielenkiintoista aihepiiriä.
So here we are on the way to London to meet Titus Hjelm. He's the doctor of theology and social studies, and he's also a musician who plays in a band called Thunderstone, and he is the stepson of our keyboard player Esa.
Metal has always been linked with Satan and Satanism. Even Kimmo's music has been claimed to contain satanic messages. But the relationship between music and religion has always been tricky. Blues, ragtime, and rock and roll have all been called devil's music. Finnish Doctor of Theology, Titus Schelm, is also a heavy metal bass player in the band Thunderstone that took part in the Eurovision Song Contest in 2007. He's written his doctorate on construction of Satanism in Finnish news media.
80s, when everything related to metal was satanic, and from that, how can you suddenly have the heavy metal masses in Finland? There's not really even any kind of big opposition to it, because it couldn't happen here.
I would say that it's a very Helsinki point of view if you say that there is no opposition to it, because I mean, that might be true in Helsinki, but you don't have to go much further away from Helsinki that you will probably find a lot of opposition to bringing metal into the church. It's not only the sort of conservative Christians in Finland or anywhere else that are concerned about it. Sort of the younger people in the church are a bit concerned that is this really something that we should do, because of the lingering image that metal has something to do, which is always oppositional to the values of the church, which is of course not true necessarily. There is a certain strand of metal, especially the Norwegian kind of black metal, sometimes called satanic black metal, which is explicitly satanic. I mean, again, you can argue how much it has to do with a serious, systematic worldview of a person or a community, but still it's explicitly, the lyrics are explicitly satanic, and sort of the whole outlook of the band is satanic.
Tapaus paljastui viime syksynä, kun Hyvinkään kaatopaikalta löytyi miehen jalka.
One of the most gruesome and most publicized murder cases of recent history in Finland was the so-called Hyvinkä incident, where a group of youngsters tortured, killed, chopped, and discarded their friend after a wild party and listening to black metal. Titus covers the murder case in his doctorate studies.
Obviously, the main perpetrator has himself said that it had nothing to do with Satanism. That, well, he is a Satanist, but his worldview doesn't have anything to do with human sacrifice or anything. That it was something that happened when they were drunk and obviously went over the edge and did a terrible thing, which is unexcusable. But to claim it as a ritual sacrifice is going way beyond, anything we know.
You don't see it as systematic as that?
No, I don't even see a religion in what the people did. There were like two problems. First of all, the media, of course, took the bait and started talking about the satanic
cool
ritual.
Story.
Yes, of course, it's the best story probably that the sort of prime news has ever had in Finland.
Yes,
it's very gross. The whole thing was very gross, and then add the sort of ritualistic element to it. But then the problem was, of course, also that the experts that were used were mostly coming from this very charismatic Christian, evangelical background. And they even testified to seeing that they went to the flat where the murder happened and saw this dark energy coming from the corner of the room. And I was like, is this something you can actually say in a Finnish courthouse? Courtroom. It's really surprising. And these were taken at face value for the most part. You can explain a thing with one word only. It was Satanism.
And you can explain a lot of behaviors.
Yes.
What does a psychiatrist think about this? Can music make you kill somebody? In Helsinki, we meet psychiatrist in chief of Finnish Student Mental Health Service, Kari Pulkkinen.
Can you blame the music, like a lot of people are blaming? And that used to be the old thing, that heavy metal was blamed for everything, right? So.
Well, there's music and use of music, which must be kept separate, I think.
Yeah.
You can misuse a kitchen knife. So it's not, you can't blame heavy if people misuse it for obscure purposes. Basically, I think heavy music is good. It's good for many situations in life, and you can make a murder in opera too. I don't think that is true. The accusation that the music as itself is dangerous, or Then if some people connect it to such stories as Satanism and so, so many things can be connected in that way.
The link between metal music and the dark forces won't leave us alone, and the discussion will continue later. Back in Finland, and in the coldest midwinter, there's the Finnish Metal Expo. The freezing north wind doesn't stop queues forming. This is a popular event. Tickets were sold out. FME is a proper metal industry get-together for record labels, music managers and promoters, magazines, manufacturers and, of course, bands and fans alike. This is a good opportunity for Kimmo and Tanya to meet some old friends.
Hello.
Hello.
Now we must speak English.
How are
you? Kuusimme, Kimmo.
Terve. Juha Ruokangas.
So you're basically, you do handmade guitars?
Yeah, I've had the company, you know, for 12 years, and nowadays we build maybe 100-120 guitars a year.
All right.
And of which about 80% goes to either Germany or USA, UK, Japan,
all right, cool.
Or Europe, so...
Mulla on mikrofoni päällä.
Voi perkele!
Catering garments for the sexy ladies of the metal scene. There's Morticia doing brisk business at the expo.
Finnish scene is amazing. People are beautiful and there are so many good bands and lots of to do. 5 years ago I thought that Helsinki is like full of shit, I don't want to live here. But nowadays there is gig every week, there is always something to do. This is very nice and tourists are coming here more and more, and I'm really proud to live in Helsinki. So welcome to Finland. There are lots of free beer and beautiful people. Welcome. It's like we're Dean guitars.
Dean guitar, okay, of course. Yeah.
The music, it's like my passion. Helps me in every emotion I go through. All kind of heavy stuff, you know. So that's good.
Same here, runs in the family.
Yeah, we're sisters.
So, yeah.
This is metal. Beautiful women and hairy men. Since everybody's here, the expo gives us the chance to chat with some of the mighty men and backing forces of Finnish metal, who have kept the metal scene going, even during the times when it wasn't this popular. Klaus Flaming is a legendary rock DJ and the smooth voice of metal.
So, when did you start?
My first broadcast was April 17th, 1988.
Yeah.
So it's just about 20 years ago.
Yeah.
And the first program was 45 minutes. That was per month.
A month?
Yes.
All right.
Those were the early days.
Yeah, and now you work for the radio rock.
Which really rocks.
And that's like a daily, you have...
2 hours a day.
2 hours a day, yeah. When do you kind of think that the Finnish heavy metal started to fly? What were the first bands that you could say?
Definitely
the
Sarge Fighters.
Well, we kind of have started, but we didn't really fly. I think we were going like...
Well, you just didn't have the right push.
No, yeah,
that's
no.
The problem.
There wasn't anybody.
No, those
time.
Were the ancient days.
Yeah, that was, yeah, yeah. Stone was perhaps the first band for me that I was really thinking, oh, these guys actually can play very well. That
Stone opened a lot of doors for another speed metal bands, you know, so every record company wanted to have their own speed metal band.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Even those who didn't understand the genre were blown away by the band's technical brilliance. Metal scene's multitasking man, Jone Nikola, has written the book about the late 1980s metal boom.
Between 1988 and 2000, so it covered the speed metal years up until the situation when Nightwish and him and bands like that started to really, you know, sell big numbers abroad as well. So that after the very short period of a speed metal, thrash metal boom, when you actually were signed to bigger labels and were given decent budgets and so forth, once that sort of like imploded, you know, guys in the bands realized that nobody's gonna sign us anyway, so we can just, you know, let's just play what we want. Yeah. And, you know, go underground into tape trading business and so forth. And that meant that the scene was very strong. It was very much, you know, band and fan driven. Yeah. And the middlemen were nowhere to be seen. Yeah. And at that time, it happened to the whole international metal market as well. It was an era when the Anglo-American center of rock music kind of like lost its upper hand. Yeah, and it became an international phenomenon, you know. Brazil, you know, spawned Sepultura. Yeah. German bands started making international success stories. And it was all through the underground market. And the Cold War era was beyond those guys. They were 17, 18 in the early 90s. You know, they sort of like, you know, they woke up to the Europe that was totally different from their previous generations of musicians as well.
Joni has to run. He's working here as an announcer.
Lauri Porra!
Bass virtuoso Lauri Porra has some serious music roots. His great-grandfather was the world-famous Finnish classical composer Jean Sibelius. A worldwide study about parallels between personality and music tastes by the Heriot Watt University in Edinburgh concluded that, aside from their age difference, both heavy metal and classical music fans are basically the same kind of person. Many of the Finnish metal stars have a classical training, often provided by the Sibelius Academy, and they are ready to mix these genres freely.
What I was doing.
Yeah.
But of course, classical and heavy metal, they have so many similarities.
Funny, that's what I was saying in the 80s, and everybody was kind of beating me up because of that. Originally, it was heavy rock, like
yeah, of
Led
course.
Zeppelin second.
That's how they changed, because for you, Led Zeppelin was heavy rock.
Yes.
But when I was, you know, some years later, got into it, so it was classic rock. The main thing about metal is the state of mind, in a way.
Yeah.
Because it's, of course, like, it's loud and it's brutal, mostly. Yeah. And also, I think that's one of the key points why it's so big in Finland. Because metal is about honesty. And a Finnish man is a righteous man.
Yes. Stay heavy or something.
I stay as heavy as I can.
Yeah.
Not much.
Yeah. This is the proper heavy metal belly. Yeah. You have to work on this. It's too hard.
I already fucked up my back with headbanging. So,
that's what I was thinking, that there must be a lot of neck injuries from that.
Yeah,
stuff.
At least I have.
Finnish metal has definitely made it in the mainstream, when even the Finnish pop idol competition was won by a young heavy metal singer, Ari Koivunen.
Did you believe that you could win it?
No, because I wasn't going there.
Yeah.
Yeah, my friend took me there when I was drunk.
All right.
Pushed me like, sing.
Because Finland probably is the only country where you could actually win it with heavy metal.
Yeah, maybe,
weirdness
but...
Weirdness of Finland. Yeah. I think that people would be happy about if you win, like, you know, the idol in metal, because that's amazing.
Finnish Metal Expo also hands out annual metal awards to the best bands, album covers, musicians, DJs and promoters.
So this is like mixed festival and actually at the same time biggest music fair
existing in Finland.
Yeah. Do you have big new plans
for this one?
Yeah.
I think this is perfect formula for this event. So if it works, why to fix it?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Why are you in Finland of all the places?
Because I love the cold.
Yeah. So we are.
Two reasons. One is, are we doing a lot of business with Finland? This whole convention is different from the other typical music conventions such as MIDEM in France or Popcom in Germany. But this one here is really dedicated to metal.
Yeah.
And that's our business. And
Finnish metal is really big in Germany. It's always been.
Huge.
Why? You have never analyzed it.
No. As long as we sell records, we don't ask why.
Kimmo ran into the first Sarcophagus singer, Hannu Leiden, who was busy promoting his label's bands. International heavy metal business people flock to this metal expo. Papa Wilska has been in every other famous Finnish metal band. Does he have an insight into the beginnings of the Finnish metal success?
Speaking of noises, Amorphis, Impel Nazarene, bands like these, they suddenly, from a small country, these guys got like record deals in America.
Yeah.
And that, I think, did something to the musicians, like, wow, suddenly we can get somewhere.
Yeah.
And that bred bands, which bred other bands. And
metal needs its backing forces and organizers, but it wouldn't be popular without the dedicated followers who buy the record and the t-shirt and come to the concerts. The youngest visitor to this expo was a real metal child. There is a good reason for Ronnie's look. His father Tony is a roadie who has worked with bands like Children of Bodom. This little boy has met all the metal greats. They do start young in Finland.
This is nice. People are very kind and
it sounds fucking great.
This is very great.
There is so much people like us.
Why metal is metal? I think it makes your body like vibrating. You can't just keep your leg on still. It starts to shake.
You've been dealing with a lot of youngsters.
Yeah.
And
that's my job.
Yes. So do you see that it can be harmful, metal and the aggression in the music? And
what happens for any one of us in every country, mm-hmm. when we come to adolescence,
yeah.
our body changed. You have to live in a new body.
Mm.
And our relationships change. We are not anymore in the center of the family when we grow up. We are too big there.
Yeah.
And heavy music, it's kind of coming through the skin.
Yeah.
It gives you kind of new skin, new sort of security, better identity in the existence where you are very, very unsecure of yourself. It has been always the trend and the need of young people in the adolescent culture to take distance to the adult world.
Mm.
That started with Elvis Presley. That's important for the growth.
Yeah.
So I see heavy music as a basis for growth.
Yeah.
Power. Strength. Whatever. I can't remember.
Do you see the metal as man's music?
No, not anymore.
Yeah.
Back in the 80s it was. 99.666% of the audience was male. But now maybe it's 70-30.
What's called female heavy metal
band?
I know one.
Yeah, I know one too. Sarcophagus.
Yeah, the ladies.
Yeah.
Yeah.
No, Sarcophagus, because they're vocalist.
Yeah.
I'm not worthy.
Anything else, my dear?
No, I think that's about that.
Okay, can we move on? All right.
Yeah. All right.
Okay.
Was it supposed to happen?
In one of the Helsinki heavy metal bars, we meet Tony Televa, the the ideas man behind many of the big Finnish metal events. Finnish Metal Expo, Tuska Festival, magazines, record labels, bands and venues. He tells us about the rise of the Finnish scene.
I started hanging around in the music business since 1988, doing like Metal Mondays at nearby Tavastia, about now it's closed, that place, but the name called Backstage. And we had lots of bands in there, that it's like a Stone, Air Dust, even Stratovarius, shit like that playing there.
Yeah.
And then came Teatro.
Yeah.
Just figure out if, okay, we're gonna stay here because it's huge states. Okay, first version of him came to me because there are two guys that are working at the bar over there. So it's a, and we make a deal. Okay, cool. I book you guys playing own shows if you can play for me in a New Year's Eve party. Ville agreed that and Van is all they want to do it.
Yeah.
The rest is history, as they say. Ville Valo and him became the shining star of the Finnish metal and a huge international success story.
Because you kind of started also before this really started to fly, the Finnish metal. So
we've talked with Tony Taleva and
he helped us out on our first gigs, and he was the guy sorting out. Teatro was the name of the club, and that was the one place before. That's where we had all the parties. We played with Apocalyptica. We played. That was the first gig, our official gig as His Infernal Majesty. We played a cover set of Typo Negative's songs, and Apocalyptica obviously played Metallica.
Yes.
And that's where it all started. I still got the posters. It's from 95 or something like that, 96.
And finally, that was 97, Teatro falling down because some idiot owner just stole the fucking money and everything, you know? Yeah. And that's a little bit, you know.
So business story.
Me, Ville, and another guys and girls, we drink about a few days. Totally drinking, not so like a few wine and beer, but it's a totally blast. When I finally wake up about 3 or 4 days, I have a terrible nightmare. Do it festival. Yeah. I was, what the fuck? And I wake up and there's a fucking ridiculous nightmare. So some monk came, do a festival. And just after the work, I'm going back.
So like a religious moment.
Yeah, that's my
sign.
Book them and they will come. Yeah. And I go to work and once again drinking. And next morning when I wake up, once again, same nightmare. Same guy, same monk came, slapped my head and told me, I told you, do it festival. And then I wake up, okay, what I can do? This is a Friday.
Yeah.
What we need? Festival, people, information, advertising. Okay, what we don't have? We don't have metal magazine. So it's a main thing doing own magazine.
The bar was closed today, but the bar manager Timo came to open the doors for us for the interview. We travelled to Tampere, 200 kilometres from Helsinki, to get tattoos. Tampere is one of the biggest cities of Finland, a busy place of industry and commerce, in a beautiful location between steep hills and lakes. Tampere has also always had a lively indie rock and heavy metal scene.
And here's a real heavy metal car. You get one of these free with a tattoo.
But how much is the tattoo?
Yes.
Juho Juntunen is a legendary rock reporter, writer, cartoonist, illustrator and tattoo artist.
Ready to feel the pain.
Yes,
He now marks us with the old Egyptian and sarcophagus band symbol, the Eye of Horus.
Because we kind of met really long time ago. Must be about 30 years ago.
Something like that, yeah.
Because I think you wrote the first story about sarcophagus.
Yeah, I suppose I was about something 25 at that time. I was living in Helsinki. And I remember you, you were a strange young kid.
Skinny little kid.
Yeah.
Who talked too much.
Yeah.
Yes. I was very persistent. I've always been, I think.
Yeah.
That helped.
The first real heavy metal song I heard was by Black Widow. It was
all right, yeah.
Come to the Sabbath, to say
that. Yeah,
there.
Yeah, that's my
that
favorite.
That was a great
yeah.
song.
Yeah. It is, yeah.
It's, and
yeah.
After that I knew that there's something in heavy metal.
Yeah, yeah.
I've been thinking that there must be something dangerous in rock and roll music.
Yeah.
Yes.
As the new singer of Sarcophagus, Tanya also gets the tattoo. In Juho's words, it's nice to be naughty. And in Juho's world, American bikes and cars, booze and smokes, rock and tattoos, all go hand in hand. It's an overall lifestyle. Respect. Since Kimmo and Tanya live in UK, it's rare that the band has an opportunity to spend time together.
Here we are at Siebel Studios.
And the now legendary old Sarcophagus lineup has re-recorded some of their 30-year-old tracks. Hannu plays some of the new mixes. Tavastia Club at the centre of Helsinki has been the cradle of Finnish rock. Anyone who's anybody in the music scene has played here. The list is long. Sarcophagus performed here in the 70s. Tuska Festival started here. If only these walls could talk. Tonight's the night for heavy rock band Blake.
Everybody is, like, you know, if you compare to us, are young. I think that's the kind of start
Ronnie
something.
Ronnie James Dio is older.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. There are a few people, yeah, who are still alive. It seems that everything here is heavy metal, but then again, I've been talking to people, the bands that I think are metal are not metal.
Mm.
And it's quite interesting to how the kind of definitions kind of change. And
Yeah, the word metal, it always, to me, it brings you in mind something modern,
yeah.
If you have a metal word in it,
yeah,
but
yeah,
heavy,
it's, kind of
it's old
password.
Style. That's
yeah.
how I think
yeah.
of them.
I don't know what was the point when the metal word, I think it probably
I think
was
Metallica and those bands brought the metal word.
Yeah, and I somehow kind of connected to the Judas Priest, Pretty Steel album, that kind of probably started to get the metal words in.
Yeah, the first time was Steppenwolf, Heavy Metal Thunder.
All right, well that's
the music.
Back. Mm. Yeah.
Like to me, Jethro Tull and Black Sabbath are almost the same to me.
Yeah.
Jethro Tull is not heavy band. It's
no,
progressive
yeah.
band, but there is and it's coming from the blues. Like heavy metal is also coming from the blues. So
yeah.
The music industry is like that. You know, younger bands, you have a, it's like a act, you know, in this break you drink. in this break you say this, you know what I mean? So they are like trained to that. You don't have spare time in the States, you don't have this, let's, in this part we do something, you know, when it's nowadays like this, you know. I think that's also killing jamming and that kind of freedom.
Why the hell people would like to kind of go like, you know, some kind of military precision? What's the
music is not about that? It's boring. Yeah, and it's just every time it's like it's the same.
New Finnish acts are making an impact in the international music scene. One band that seems to have a bright future is Norther, mixing melodic and death metal. We meet the Norther guitarist Christian Ranta at their rehearsal studio.
Ideana niin just se,
death metal is based on fast and hard-hitting guitar riffs and presents special requirements for the instrument. We also talk with guitarist Tom and a guitar maker, Tommy, from Amphisound.
It's quite hard to kind of do anything anymore, like, you know, that would be totally,
well,
like, shocking, because everything is done and...
Well, yeah, but I disagree, because actually, think about Meshuggah. They totally changed the whole thing.
Yes.
They did something really different.
Yeah.
But still, the guys use the same instruments, like basically, you know, same kind of instruments.
Yes.
But the music is something totally different.
Yeah. And they use 8-string guitars, that you have one there.
That's really low. Yeah.
So it changes the whole concept of playing riffs.
Get it clean, Tom. Rare, the 8-string thing, like, you know, that I've been thinking about these things and never seen one.
It's something I worked at. I can't guarantee that I remember it correctly, but this is a little bit of Johann Sebastian Bach.
That's very nice.
We want to live the, like, this whole heavy metal life, and also like make heavy metal guitars with good people, like here, artists.
There are some specific needs what you have when you need to play like fast and kind of like have a certain kind of sound from the guitar and stuff like that.
So yeah.
Basically, that's why these guys make really good guitars, because they know what those needs are.
Yeah.
The machine gun guitar is especially made for Kursk, a Finnish doom metal band that sings in Russian and bases its whole style to the Russian military look.
From that.
So how does the shape of this, does it, do we have problems with the sound?
It sounds actually really good.
It's
really good to play also.
It was time to wrap up our winter trip to Finland. It started to look like the film was going to be far more comprehensive than we first anticipated. Right after our return, Norther and Turistus were touring Britain. We run into young lads who went to see their Brighton gig. In true English style, we meet them in a pub around the corner.
Something new, isn't it? I mean, a lot of the bands like sort of called Flakani and Turistus and stuff are doing something new, because they've got the whole sort of folk thing as well.
Does it have like an exotic factor to you then?
Yeah,
definitely.
It's also a lot more sort of get out and party, whereas a lot of other metal's sort of
bit dreary.
Dreary, yeah, miserable.
How big you see this Finnish metal here in Britain? That
I think you'd have to look for it to find it.
Yeah,
you wouldn't just walk around and sort of notice things like advertised or see these in shops. You'd actually have to make a point to go and look for it.
Your father is a priest.
If I ever brought CDs of heavy metal home, he'd break them in half straight away and tell me it was terrible and that it didn't take talent to make. And
so does he see the metal as satanic?
He sees the Finnish metal as satanic, funnily enough.
Oh, right.
A lot of the Finnish, he would hate that a lot more than a lot of what comes out of Britain or America. Blood Red Sandman. I had on once, and he would just take one look at their costumes, and straight away it's the devil singing for a band of mummies, and demons and whatever else, and you just hate it straight away and turn it off, and you're never listening to Lawley again. Anything like that. Ridiculous.
Oh, this is so funny. Mm. It's just like we are still in dark ages.
Yeah. It's 5 in the morning.
So here we are going to Stansted, heading for Tusko Festival in Finland.
This time our hard-working graphic designer Matt Petch gives us a lift to the airport. Summertime, and the rock festival season is in full swing in Finland. We fly to Stockholm, Sweden, and the same afternoon board a ferry to Helsinki.
How does Helsinki look like?
Very beautiful. I have a new friend.
Does he speak English?
No. Russian.
Summer is short and fierce in Finland, and people make the most of it. The whole country goes a bit loopy during these nightless months. And every self-respecting town has some kind of music festival. Not surprisingly, most of them seem to be dedicated to the metal mania. But almost all summer festivals feature a few metal lineups. Looking at the festival calendar in UK, the music scene is a bit different. Apart from the Reading Festival, heavy metal shines with its absence.
Even the pop songs and all the, if you go back to the kind of traditional songs like Hindrik and all these are very, very grim.
Sure, there is certain great amount of sadness in the so-called Finnish character.
Yeah.
But it's also a capacity to feel sorry for somebody lost, and you don't get panicked immediately after some disaster happens around you. So it's I would like to see that more in the positive way. Isn't heavy music for me? It is like permission to feel.
Mm.
It is comes as an attack.
Yeah,
gives you sort of permission to express your anger, so yeah, your whatsoever you feel. And if you live in the area where you have not too many opportunities, you are alone. That's only a music permission to feel for a person in the lonely situation.
Yeah.
And therefore, Finland is as a country like that. And especially for young people, it's very important that you have the permission to feel.
Yes, yeah.
Tuska Festival, in English, Pain Festival, is one of the biggest music events in Finland and entirely dedicated to extreme metal. Central location, top lineup, sold out tickets. A typical Finnish summer scene. Tuska is also one of the most peaceful events, a trouble-free zone with good security and clean-up crew. That is why it gets the permission to get organised in a big park in the centre of Helsinki every year. How is this possible? We run into some familiar faces here.
I've been to Tuska for 11 years, since the very first year.
Oh, it's been going so long.
Yeah, now we started it out from Tavastia Club. It was two stages in a club.
Yeah.
It's grown rapidly but steadily. Well, what you see here now is a very traditional Tuska audience, you know. Yeah. Metal people come from all over the place, you know, they come as far from, you know, from Lapland.
Yeah.
And we have like journalists from, say, 20 different countries.
Yeah.
And
they knock of us.
Yeah, knock of us in Indonesia.
Yeah. And they had to borrow money to get here.
Yeah, so let's just hope that the t-shirts sell.
Yeah.
Grindcore metal band Noxa came from the other side of the world to play a devastating set in Finland. Their journey being so epic that the band had their own documentary film crew following it. Good luck for the production.
I'm alone or are we the band?
Yeah, don't you be home. Everybody, yeah.
Harus dibilangin aja ya. Cek aja ya. Bilangin kita ngutang ya, biar mereka tahu.
that one, then.
Yeah. Oh, it's crazy. We borrow like $7,000 to flew here.
I'm here. Yeah, right, yeah.
To borrow with some friends. It's crazy. And this is our great experience.
Yes, yeah.
Yeah, we never played in Europe before. We just played in Singapore and Malaysia. That's our neighborhood.
Yeah.
That's the nearest to us. So.
Yeah.
Yeah. We are so surprised that a lot of audience supports us, like yelling to us and horn to us. Oh, it's so amazing. Yeah. Finland's amazing.
Yeah. Any other questions?
Come on!
And guests from the West, Killswitch Engage, all the way from the USA. It'll be interesting to hear what these veterans of hardcore heavy metal think of the atmosphere. Some of the band members even claim to be fans of Finnish metal music.
There's places where metal's accepted, but the fact that extreme music is mainstream here in a lot of ways, that's pretty cool.
Yeah.
You don't really see that anywhere else, you know?
No.
Yeah.
You don't see that. It's nice. Yeah.
It's kind of cool that, you know, it's moved from being underground to something that's this big, yeah, but it can still be something that you hold personal.
Yeah.
The influential British grindcore metal band Carcass was one of the top foreign names in the Helsinki summer.
How do you see this Finnish metal scene?
Well, I mean, Finland's the most heavy metal place on the planet, isn't it? It really is. I mean, the joke used to be Japan, you know, that they were totally into heavy metal. You could be an obscure metal band, be massive in Japan, be nothing anywhere else. And now, you know, Finland's just... I mean, we're just driving around the town, I was talking to Daniel, who's drumming with us, and you can't tell, you know, who's coming to this concert and who isn't. Everyone's dressed in black, and half the population is, you know... into metal or goth or, you know, the gothic thing, and you know, you've got national radio playing metal.
Yes.
You don't get that in England. Or...
No, all the channels are playing metal.
Yeah, it's just
going to switch from channel to channel.
Yeah. I mean, the thing is with Finns as well, it's a very image-driven thing, I think.
Yeah.
You know, people take it really seriously. Mm. Even, like, people in the crowd look like they could be on stage because the way... I mean, look at me, I'm just a tramp, you know, but... they're like the band in Helsinki, the image is, like, really important, you know. Maybe you're all posers in Finland.
Yeah.
And the prize of the dedicated foreign reporter goes to...
So, okay, here we are with a guy from Uruguay who is doing stories about Finnish metal bands, and... Why? Why are you here?
Why am I here? That's a long way, exactly. Yes, more than one day. One of the first bands I was interested in, the Finnish metal bands, were Amorphis.
Okay.
And I really fell in love with the band, with the sound. From that point, I started to listen to other Finnish metal bands and discover a whole new world.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm in love with Scandinavian metal bands.
Yeah.
I've been waiting for a long time to make this tour. You know, it is really very, very expensive for South America because the euro is quite high.
Yeah.
It's really great to be here, to be part of this fest, and to see, to experiment how the European guys live this experience.
Yeah.
Because I have been in many metal shows and metal festivals in Uruguay, but also in Argentina, where you can find bigger stadiums and bigger shows. But Europe is totally different.
Yes, totally different.
And this is the first day of the Tuska, the first time here, and it's really amazing. You don't see that even in Argentina.
Yes. Do you have the magazine there that you're
working for? I have a magazine and a radio show, and I'm covering this festival exclusively for...
So you get at least something paid, you know, from your...
No, it's all from the heart.
You're a true believer.
Yeah.
Fantastic.
Thank you. Nice to meet you.
And enjoy.
Thank you very much, and thank you very much for the interview.
Yeah. You're from Sweden, so this is very different.
Yeah, I mean, over here it's a lot bigger, I think, than in Sweden. I mean, it's big in Sweden too, I shouldn't say that, but it's more, here it's like with Lordi and stuff, that wouldn't happen in Sweden.
Yes, yeah.
So that's, you know, it's way cooler here.
Yeah.
Dimmu Borgir represents the underground Norwegian black metal. However, with their latest recordings, they have made a breakthrough into the mainstream metal market.
Fuck yeah! Live into the sky! For those of you who don't know, we are delivering it from Norway.
The Serpentine!
What do you think about Finland and Finland kind of going mainstream heavy metal crazy?
It's killer, of course. Yeah. I would rather want metal everywhere than anything else everywhere. We are quite fortunate to have devoted fans everywhere we go. It's a different thing here in Finland because, you know, even if we get into the charts in Norway, we don't stay on the charts, you know. It's like here in Finland, it's the bands still stay on the charts.
So I think that metal is underground and metal should be against the system. And it's
and it is. It really is. Yeah. Even if it's even if it comes on television or radio or whatever, it's never going to be like Britney Spears or stuff like that because this is true music, you know.
Yeah. After the expo, we had yet another Eurovision Song Contest and with a metal song. Yeah. And that just somehow proved the points discussed back in the day.
Yeah.
That the mainstream of metal in Finland is kind of like, you know, everybody's thing. Yeah. Not just a genre of music, but rather a part of the mainstream popular culture.
Yeah. And because even last year there was a thunderstorm.
Yeah.
They were. After Lordi, there's always been metal bands in.
Yeah.
The general acceptance of metal is also reflected in the festival audience. Some bring their families with them.
Young metalheads.
Yes.
The sensitive ears of the smaller members being sensibly protected.
He's called the Dead.
Whole families have grown up listening to metal. This is also true to Sarcophagus, the band members having inspired the next generation of metalheads.
So you are the nephew of our last album drummer, Upi Sorvali.
Yes, that's true.
Yeah.
I actually listened to it just a very small moment ago, actually, that album.
He was an absolutely fantastic drummer.
And a heavy metal grandmother is a sight for sore eyes in the midst of this metal crowd. She was looking for a souvenir so that her family would believe her adventure.
What do you think?
Oh, very different. And also that I am not dressed the right way.
Next but, time, no. I am black.
Yes, but
well, at least you stand out.
Nightwish is one of the biggest success stories coming from Finland. Hugely popular melodic metal band, filling venues, winning awards and selling records all over the world. Music made with magical beauty and an operatic female singer. At Tuska, we got hold of Marco, who is the bass player and second singer in Nightwish, but also plays in Taro, by now a well-established pioneering metal band.
Remember my Sarcophagus band, which was like from 78 to 82?
Because I got your first album as a gift from my friend when I got my confirmation from the church, which is politically incorrect about thing about heavy metal anyway.
Because if it becomes really popular, that does it? Do you think that
mainstream?
Yeah, and can it still survive then? Or
okay, so if we talk about, for instance, Nightwish, it's for sure that we got a lot of like a fan base and, let's say, for instance, in a middle-aged housewives, otherwise we wouldn't be selling like four times platinum in Finland unless they would be buying the albums.
Yeah.
So in a way with Nightwish, it's a kind of a thing that you got these really like sensitive parts, you got a really, really like atmospheric beauty in the whole thing.
Yeah.
But then there's this danger of always getting over the line and suddenly coming up with something that is really at your face. And that is one of the best things that I find myself in the band, because you can define it as a mainstream. It doesn't have a structure for it. It's not like verse, chorus kind of thing. It is a kind of a mind flow thing.
Yeah.
But if we go to the extreme end of metal, when we got bands today hear like Slayer and stuff like that, I don't think it'll ever be able to become mainstream. Yeah. I mean, it can become really popular, that much we have seen.
Yeah.
But there's always going to be people who will find that it's too much for them.
Yeah.
There's always going to be people like that.
Yeah.
Another band enjoying mainstream metal success is Him, currently making waves in the USA, where its frontman Bill Lavallo enjoys almost cult-like following.
What do you think about this, that metal is mainstream in Finland?
Well, for me personally, it's great since it enables me to pay my rent.
Yeah.
So, I guess that on the same level as Norway. Finland is great that you can have Cradle of Filth being number one, Madonna being number two, and us being number three or whatever on the official charts, which that never happens anywhere else.
Yeah.
Not in the States, not in the UK. Mm. And I think that that's pretty healthy.
But there's another end to this stick. The often satanic black metal bands oppose the mainstream culture in general. So much so that we faced some difficulty finding musicians willing to defend their genre in this project. Black metal followers are happy to spread their message in underground metal fanzines rather than in mainstream film. We are happy to find Enochian Crescent, one of the leading black metal bands in Finland, willing to talk to us. We met them at a fitting location, in a cemetery.
Because you are kind of labeled as a black metal band.
That is
so
true.
What does it mean?
To us, black metal is mainly about the attitude.
Yeah.
How to do things.
Yeah.
Music-wise, image-wise, and basically the whole lifestyle.
Yes.
I don't see particularly anything bad about metal being mainstream in a sense, because it's great music and a great way of people getting to know the music.
Yeah.
Also, but the church and metal music, they don't match in my eyes.
Is the kind of Satanism part of it, or the kind of Lucifer?
For some, yes.
But that's not necessary.
Anti-religion is a strong theme also. All the organized religions are at fail, in a sense, in our point of view.
Okay,
so,
yeah.
A true faith is something else than what is written in books or told in churches or temples.
Yeah, because
basically you should find it within yourself.
Yeah.
And not believe what someone else tells you.
Yeah.
So even the church has found out that the people are more willing to believe in their God if they use our language.
Yeah.
The pagan's language, you know. The church has always been against everything that takes people's attention away from the church.
Yeah.
Whether it be art or music or, you know, or artistic music. You know, it's a free world. I don't have to buy into that shit. I don't have to go to the mass. Or I can listen to Dark Throne, but I don't have to believe in Satan.
No.
In that sense, very satanic in an Anton LaVey kind of sense, that it is the freedom of choice, you know, when it comes to metal. You listen to whatever you want, and there's little tribes within the metal.
Yeah.
Lappajärvi, back in the late 90s, and it was a great gig. We performed on a little stage, and there was like half of the audience were people with corpse paint.
Yeah.
And half of the audience were Jehovah's Witnesses or whatever, holding their Bibles and having their eyes closed and praying for us. And that really happened. It was really weird. And then they started beating up each other and we had to stop. We've always been the ones falling in between of different genres. I don't really mind if somebody believes in whatever, if it helps that particular person to cope with life.
Yeah.
Life is pretty tough in itself, so whatever it might be, if it's Moomin or if it's Christian God or whether it's an old fertility symbol nowadays called by Christianity, Satan or Lucifer, the bringer of light, Lucifer. So it doesn't really matter, you know, whatever makes people happy.
Yeah.
There is a religious or anti-religious side to metal music, and metal musicians hardly look like angels. The colour black, the leather, the studs, and the fake blood. The visual side of metal is strong, and often the look and the music become one. Where does this connection between the music and the specific look come from?
These two
Ruska. Everybody has a hell of a time.
Yeah.
That's cool. I've had my share of pain.
When it became metal from heavy rock?
Well, to me, the way I see it, it started in Birmingham, you know? That's the birthplace of heavy metal,
to me.
You know, Priest and Sabbath.
Yeah, because that's, I would connect Judas Priest for the metal word, in a way.
Me too.
Steel and...
Definitely, yes. Yeah. Definitely. Yeah. Priest was also the first band to incorporate more image type of style, you know, clothing and dressing up and stuff. And that's, to me, that's what metal is about. It's about... the connection between the visual stuff and the music, and together it becomes art. So,
You see your music more like heavy rock, or
it's heavy rock. Yes. It's definitely heavy rock or hard rock. The German label, they started marketing us as monster metal or something.
Okay.
Well, we can be called monster metal, but most and foremost, it's rock.
Yeah, we had the kind of urge to be visual.
Mm-hmm.
And we had the same thing that we kind of dressed up for the stage,
mm-hmm.
and it was quite important for me that that when I'm off the stage, like me, and you kind of have the same.
Well, not kind of. We have the same. And to me, for myself, I have never gotten the idea that why the hell should I or anybody pay for a ticket to see a band when there's nothing, you know, worth seeing for. Lordy, without makeup on, you know, live on stage, don't come, don't pay the ticket, there's nothing worth seeing for. There's absolutely, and we would sound the same, but there's absolutely nothing worth seeing for, you know.
I wouldn't want to make gigs like every week, because I want to make them special kind of happenings, performances. And if we made gigs regularly, I think it would diminish the effect.
Can you describe a special kind of event? What happens in your gigs?
There are lots of stuff. Blood. I cut myself with scissors, and there's a rain of feathers and such.
Yeah.
And wheelchairs. Omega flags there.
Yeah.
So you're very visual.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. There are lots of planned happenings at every show, and mainly, of course, our vocalist is the orchestra meister there, because his hands are not tied, and he's a very good at conjuring up these images and very strong vision of how band should look like on stage.
Yeah. If you have a metal set of mind, that how you see differently things like Giger's art, that a lot of people find it very disturbing. I don't. I think it's really beautiful. And
for me, my favorite is Witkin, Joe Peter Witkin.
Yeah.
He took photographs usually about dead or deformed people.
All right. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Danzig's third album has the Giger piece in the Danzig cover, and then Debbie Harry used that in the 80s, and sure, horror movies and what else, you know, and the whole shebang.
So where's the connection with heavy metal
and horror?
They both break the rules of convention in a sense. They bring something else to a normal life, you know. They show you what's under the bed and in the closet, you know.
Yeah.
That's
a
very good answer, thank you.
No problem.
Happy to serve.
Yeah.
Big fan.
The heartogram symbol of him is just as well known as the band is. It's a clever combination of pentagram and the love metal message.
Well, it's a great symbol.
That's
I don't need any last words on my tombstone. Just need the symbol. Exactly. That's the best thing I've done. Probably the best thing I'll ever do.
Yeah.
I'm not a graphic designer or anything like that, but it's just, you know, the big fan of Zeppelin and their four symbols and all that, you know, it's just... And symbols travel so well when you don't have the language barrier.
What makes Finnish metal so popular? Is there such a thing as the unique Finnish sound?
It's moody. It's very, very moody.
All the Finns are quite, moody.
Oh, yeah. I like the fact that I can listen to that stuff, and no matter how bad I feel, I can put in something from here and just say, that guy feels worse than I do.
Yeah.
But it's dark, and it's, like, emotional, but it's also very genuine, and it's really cool.
Nightwish is probably one of the biggest influences for bands.
Yeah, that's true. I mean,
it's...
it's pretty obvious now when you look at it how many like different groups are coming out with the same kind of recipe. And it's a recipe that seems to be copied quite a lot these days.
Because for me, like,
and then you get a girl singer.
Yes, yes.
Another globe-trotting melodic metal band whose name has already popped up many times is Sonata Artica, led by singer Tony Kakko. Our interview was cruelly interrupted by the arrival of Slayer. Everyone else was kicked out from the backstage.
We're over there waiting for you.
Yeah, so we have to continue now because Slayer throw us out.
Yeah, we got slayed.
Yeah, slayed by Slayer. But there's like a new strand of metal that has something that is unique to Finland, like Stratovarius and these bands. That have they created that? Do you think that?
Yes, they kind of gave this good stamp to all things metal. Yeah. In Finnish, in, when it's from Finland, it's good. Yeah. You know, and Finvox Studios, of course, well,
yeah.
Weirdly enough, I'm wearing a shirt. But they had a big meaning to the whole throwing of the metal. The big thing, at least for our career, was this Karmila Jussila axis, you know, those two from Finvox. They created our sound, you know, mixing-wise.
Yeah.
The studios and producers play an important part in the growth of the metal market, but roots go deeper. Metalheads tend to build a strong ideology behind their tastes, and metal fans are the most loyal amongst the music lovers. This is not pop music, where the names and faces change every season according to the latest whim. There is a certain stubbornness in the Finnish psyche, and metal feeds from that feeling. A good representative of the Finnish ideology is Mokoma, a chart-topping band who turned its back to international EMI, started its own record label, and runs its own affairs. They also sing in Finnish.
My mother and father might introduce me as a musician, but I always have to correct them that I'm not a musician. That would be wrong for that profession to call me a musician.
Yeah.
I'm a metal musician, and I'm paid for doing just what I did on the Tuska main stage a couple of hours ago. There's a very deep philosophical level in that. Like when we got kicked out of EMI, I think the philosophical part came up at that point, because before that we were sometimes thinking about, okay, we are on a major label, maybe like a subconsciously we should do a hit song, and
and
then we were on our own again. We just enjoyed playing with these guys, and we did some pretty funny songs which everybody liked to play and everybody liked to listen, and we did a hit record after that, so...
Well said!
With a champagne glass!
Heavy metal is not necessarily just about the volume, it's about heavy subject matter. Yeah. It's about heaviness in the mood of the music. So in that case, let's say Johnny Cash's American recordings is a lot more heavy, you know, a lot heavier as an album than 90% of heavy metal music.
Yes, yeah.
Or traditional Finnish music, which is very melancholy and very, not necessarily depressing, but it's very wistful and kind of a bit angsty.
Yeah.
Yeah, rebellion, it's of course ever present in metal music.
And it should be.
It should be, yeah.
That's,
because
I think what's gone.
That's, yeah.
Slightly.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. The thing about the mainstream and rebellion, they are both incompatible.
Yes, yeah, yeah, I
in
agree.
In a sense, because if you're accepted by the parents and the society and everything, where's the rebellion?
This is the thing that metal should be. It should be like an antithesis.
Yeah.
Like, it should be against something and not just going with the flow.
Yeah.
Time plays an important role here. When Kimmo started playing metal in the 1970s, the influences had to be found from foreign bands. Stamina started its music career 20 years later, and have released their very successful albums during this century.
When you started, where did you
pick up your influences?
Stone, Finnish band was great influence when we started.
I'm happy to say that it was a Finnish band got me started playing some guitar stuff.
Yeah.
What happened with our band was that we sang in English for 4 years, and after the year 2000 we changed into Finnish language.
Yeah. At the same time as we started this band, there was this starting bands like Nightwish and Children of Bodom, who has come so huge, and they're part of this metal coming so big in Finland. Yeah. So
some busy musicians find time to make it big in several countries. We ran into a guitarist who plays both in pioneering Finnish band Valtteri and German trash metal band Creator. Does he have an outsider's insight into the Finnish scene?
I'm drifting in the night on a calm sea. I'm flying on the edge of the night. The seagulls spread their wings, is all I see. I start to drift towards the daylight.
Is there a difference between playing in a Finnish band or a German band?
German band is like and the Finnish band is like whatever.
Okay, so it's faster and slightly darker.
Yeah, I suppose you could say that.
Yeah.
The both bands that I do, they're basically friends, you know. So that's the main thing. But I'm glad that it's possible to, that it's also a job.
There seems to be a hell of a lot of fans that are really good. And
perhaps it has something to do with the long Finnish winter and people don't have anything better to do.
Having fun?
Yeah.
On top of long winters, what makes Finland such a breeding ground for metal bands? Is there some special ingredient in the drinking water? Although hardly anyone seems to be drinking water.
A lot of people concentrate on the dark side without really seeing what lies underneath it still is the really dark sense of humor that the people as well have. I do have a sense of like a national pride. This thing that I believe that we as Finnish people, we have this certain stubborn backbone. We're persistent people with dark sense of humor, a lot of anger as well. And otherwise we wouldn't have held back Russians in the Second World War because they were tenfold to us. Yeah. There were 10 guys for one of us. And I think we all grow from that thing.
You've been meeting so many people. There's so many different attitudes towards the metal. But I do think that there's the fact that the Finnish male has a problem of getting the emotions out. And what would be easier and a stronger way than metal to get it out? More wars, more metal. You know, people need stronger things to take their mind off of the fact that our world is pretty muffed up, as they say in Philadelphia.
Metal has become a massive success story in this small country. But where can we go from here? Is there still a bright future ahead for the Finnish metal?
How do you see the future?
I believe that there's going to be a kind of a breaking point because too much heavy metal everywhere in Finland.
Do you think that this is now like, you know, at the height of it?
If I had to guess, I think it would be going down at some point because it can't grow anymore.
Yeah.
The metal bands are selling like quadruple platinum or something like that.
Yes.
So it's might be.
And maybe, if the scene winds down in Finland, it starts to gather momentum somewhere else. Folk metal band Korpiklaini just came back from the German tour.
We are actually where we want to be in thinking about our success, because we can play as much as we want.
All right.
But we are not so big that there's a problem about that.
Korpiklaini was supposed to perform at Tuska, but lost its luggage on the way from Germany. A lucky break for Before the Dawn, who got the last-minute gig.
when you were doing the stuff, you were the pioneer, and there was very limited contacts and stuff. Now there's a lot of contacts, but there's way too many bands.
Yeah.
With like very high quality, and at the markets are full of new bands, so it's like insanely difficult for the record companies also to make the promotion to get their bands.
Yeah.
It's not about even music anymore in many cases. So the competition is a bit too hard now.
All right. Yeah.
I have my own label, and I have my three own bands in the label, and I have license contracts with all of those.
Oh, okay.
So then I can make all the schedules, albums, cover art, mastering the way I want, and I also work as stage manager.
Yes.
Festival like Yalo Metalli and Ruka Open Air, Gustok, and some bigger club gigs. So I think that's the way to make some kind of living around music.
But yeah, cool.
Oh, thank you.
Yeah.
Our goal in everything has always been that we try to look cool. And if you're cool enough, and if you sound cool enough, you are international.
Just before leaving Finland, we had the wildest idea.
So here we are waiting for the interview with the president of Finland.
During our visit, we'd already met so many fantastic people. We are only missing the president.
Madam President, honor to meet you.
Nice to meet you.
Thank you for this opportunity. And we are living a time when even presidents can talk about heavy metal. And how do you feel about that?
That's fine, because I think that all different kind of arts are very necessary for the modern world and for everyone. I'm not a researcher, but if we think that we have only 5 million as a population, so it's an amazing amount of the people who are making this music and those who are listening it. I normally say that our secret is in three words: education, education, and education. But that includes also music. By the way, it's heavy metal. Perhaps it's something in our hearts that we are very passionate people. We really are passionate also concerning our hobbies.
Finland has always been known for its clean nature and technology and education. But do you mind personally that also Lordi is now part of that picture?
Do I mind? I love it. Music is, of course, an essential part of this kind of the world of arts. But I hope so that everybody is also trying to have a broad mind or different kind of the ideas in arts.
It's party time and our last night in Finland. Back on the ferry, on the way back to Sweden and then home, England. Travel weary and tired. We had some time to reflect and gain strength for the grueling post-production.
So well done.
You're taking it right.
Thank you. So you're all on?
That video would be enough.
Knowing how hard it is for bands in Finland, we had a band competition of our own on our website. We got sent tracks by over 20 unsigned or indie Finnish metal bands. Making the decision was tough, but we just instantly fell for the raw energy of Corruption Inc. Record companies out there, do something.
So now we need the drum roll. And here's the winner of the band competition, Corruption Incorporated. How does it feel now?
I'm honored to be in this documentary because this is first time when my music is in the film.
Yeah. So hopefully it will help you.
And I'm so glad. Thank you. Thank you.
promised land of heavy metal.